Okay, so it is a pleasure. We should have done this yesterday, but we were so freaking out about the interface, to introduce Dr. Angela Ortega from the Humboldt University in Berlin for her second lecture. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Well, let's continue with a little bit of our background over about abelian varieties. It was a little thing that I didn't say yesterday before going to the prime varieties. And I think Pavel mentioned today in the exercise sessions. So I think I defined it yesterday, this map beta from the symmetric product of n symmetric product of a curve. So it parametrizes the effective divisors on a curve. So curves the genus G curve into the peak n group of C. So it is the group of offline bundles of degree n on the C. So C is a curve, smooth curve. Yeah. So far, this is, everything is smooth of genus G. And so essentially, you just to take the divisor and consider the associated line bundle on it. Okay. Mm-hmm. So let's define the image of this map. Vn, the image of this map is a subset in big N. So essentially, it's all it's line bundles which so line bundles of degree N with non-empty L. So let's put the line bundles on. Line bundles of degree n with non-empty linear system. Yes? So there is effective divisors that define this line. Okay. So you know by Riemann-Roch theorem, for curves, Riemann-Roch theorem for curves, you know that when n is bigger than g, this is the whole space. So essentially, all the line bundles of degree n has have effective divisors for any at least g. This is Riemann-Roch. And then for a general divisor, in the image. For general, yes, let's write it L as line bundle for the general line bundle in peak N of C for G between one and A. N between one and G, we have only one section. This is what you expect. Okay. This is the general. Of course, you have the Brillouin-Latour law size when this you have, and this Brillouin-Latour law size will come into the picture later. Okay, so that says that beta is birational in this range. So the beta is birational with this image, birational onto its image in this range. Mm-hmm. And so Wn is birational to Cn. So in general, okay? So since beta is proper, you can show that it's a proper map. That shows that actually the image is a closed sub variety. So it's an irreducible sub variety. So irreducible, in particular, in the case we are very interested in the case where when n is g minus one, wg minus one is a divisor in peak g minus one. So this degree plays a big role in the whole theory. And this divisor is canonically associated to the core, okay? And this is what we call the canonical divisor. We will see why. Canonical theta divisor. Because it's essentially it's going to be a translation of our theta divisor depending on the Jacobian. So one can show that there is a line bundle, we call it. That is maybe not a good idea. I want to use it later. Doesn't matter. Eta in big G minus one, yeah, of this degree, such that the pullback of theta divisor is omega G one. So this alpha eta is the map that goes to from peak NC into, it's a translation essentially. You can also translate from one degree to the other. Just by tensoring, you have L and you tensor with the inverse of theta, this line bundle. Okay, something I didn't mention yesterday, but remember peak zero of C is a group. So the trivial line bundle is the zero element and the sum is tensorization of line bundles. And this it corresponds to the sum into the Jacobian. We have established this isomorphism yesterday. So the sum, the natural addition in the Jacobians translate into tensor of line bundles. So I'm going from the Jacobians as a sum of points, also line bundles of peak zero C. Okay, this is maybe I sometimes just write it and I don't see it. Okay, so it exists an eta, so you have a theta divisor on the Jacobian, you can always translate it from this canonical theta divisor on degree G minus one. But we like very much G minus one because of the following theorem. And this is the last thing I'm gonna say, is the Riemann singularity theorem. Theorem, very famous one. So you have for every line bundle of degree G minus one, yes, you want to compute the multiplicity of this canonical divisor at the point L is given by the number of sections. Yes, as I mentioned, the general element here will have only one section, yes. Only one section, and so it means in general when the element is smooth, but as soon you have two or more sections, you have a singularity of the canonical theta divisor. And this is a very nice theorem. So you really can read the singularities from the space of sections. So it is. So many things gonna come from this theorem. Now, that was from yesterday. So I want to go. So the second lecture should start here. So let me start to define the prime varieties. So today you will see prime varieties all the way. You have already saw them in the morning with the lectures. Actually, I'm very happy that the lecture happens today because you already saw the motivation on the prime varieties. So motivations appears in other contexts. Hitching fibration or this Shimura varieties and so on. So let's do it slowly. So where the motivation comes from? Okay, let me give some sort of motivation of prime varieties. The original motivation. Okay, so yesterday we saw that we have a for every curve, we can associate it with a principal polarized Abelian variety, namely it's Jacobian. So let's give names to the moduli spaces I'm gonna work with. So MG is gonna be the moduli space of parametrizing all the curves C, smooth projective curves of genus C, so up to isomorphism. So it's a classes of isomorphism of course. And I'm gonna work also with AG. AG is the modular space parametrizing pairs of abelian varieties such that A is a principally polarized abelian variety and theta is its theta divisor. So traditionally, every time that the divisor is principal, we call it theta divisor, although it's not necessarily coming from a Jacobian or from a core, it's just a principally polarized theta divisor. And it has to be done also up to isomorphisms, okay? So isomorphisms classes of these pairs. This, okay, I'm not in the position of talking about how to construct MG. It's a longer story, but there is the GIT construction. On the other hand, it's easier to tell you explicitly what is AG. So AG is gonna be the quotient of the the Siegel upper half plane on space in the plane, HG, modulo the action of a group, the symplectic group, G. Cool. So let me tell you briefly how it works, okay? Just to the Siegel upper half plane of dimension G is simply the space of all G times G matrices into complex entries such that the matrix A is symmetric, so the transposition is equals to T, and the imaginary part defines a bilinear form positive definite. So maybe that reminds you this tau that we described yesterday in the case of G equals one. G equals one is just to the upper half planes of the complex numbers. So yeah. So for each time that we took a complex number from this half plane, we could construct an elliptic curve. Okay. And the quotient by the group gives you the isometry, the isomorphism of the classes. So here acts let me put names because it's gonna be this is Siegel upper half space. And then SPG is the symplectic group of all the matrices, invertible ones, size 2G of 2G with rational entries, with the property that they preserve the polarization. So you want to preserve the polarization. So the polarization we saw, it can be represented by a matrix. So in this case, is are principally polarized. So the matrix looks like this. So this is the identity, e.g. M transpose. So is that should not change the polarization. Okay, so this group acts as a symplectic group. Symplectic group. And this symplectic group acts on the Siegel upper half plane space by so you take a matrix of the form A, B, C, D. So each one is a small matrix of the size G times G here. Okay, and we act in a matrix G times G. So you see, this is complex by the following formula. So yes, now it makes sense because A, B are matrices G times G, and then you sum this, multiply them with C plus T tau, and you take the inverse of this matrix, okay? So in such a way that every time, okay, we know you choose an element tau in HG, you can define naturally a complex torus by taking as a basis for the lattice. So that would be a basis for the lattice. just like we did yesterday for the elliptic curve, but now in more dimension, higher dimension. Mm-hmm. And we say two such complex curves are isomorphic as principally polarized abelian varieties, if only if they are related by the action of the symplectic curve. So it exists a matrix SPG, 2G, Q, such that you can go from one tau to the other. Okay? That's very explicit. You can work with that. And it's the only thing that I'm gonna say. So every point in the quotient represents an isomorphism class of a principally polarized abelian variety of dimension G. Okay, so the same construction also works for other polarizations. So, but in this case, you have to change. You have to change here the polarization. Okay, and then you get another group. But it's a similar construction. So in any case, this Siegel upper half space is the universal core of this moduli space, and in particular, you can compute the dimensions. So the dimension of AG, it would be also the dimension of the Siegel space G. And this is just parameterized by symmetric matrices. So the symmetric matrices G times G has a dimension of G plus G times G plus one over two. And this comes from this construction. Okay. See, now our Jacobian construction allows you to define a map between these two moduli spaces, namely the Torelli map. So what is the Torelli map? Mm-hmm. It's a map that associated to every curve of G and G goes to AG, it's Jacobian. So you take a class of isomorphism of curves, and you take the class of its Jacobian together with its theta divisor. Okay. This is, and the Torelli theorem, and this is the first Torelli theorem. So all the Torelli theorems you have here, Torelli type theorem, Torelli, it comes from this one. Yes, from this Torelli one. So the Torelli map is injective. It's injective. So with other words, that means you can recover the curve from the Jacobian and its polarization. You need the polarization also. With this pair, you can recover the curve. So people then start to study the moduli space AG through curves, and let's see how far can we go. So you make a little table on the dimensions. So the dimension of MG is 3G minus 3, and this works only for G at least 2. For G at least 1, you are in the case of elliptic curves, and we saw elliptic curves is isomorphic to its Jacobian. So in this case, it's an isomorphism of the Torelli. So here you have G plus 1 over 2. So for G minus 2, well, you can get 1, 1, 1. This is already one case. But from genus 2, this is dimension 3. Dimension 3, genus 3 is 6. And this is also 6. For genus 4, this is dimension 9. And this is dimension 10. Yes. For dimension 5, this is 12. For dimension, this is 15. And then you go 21. So this grows linearly and this grows quadratically in G. So my point is, this, I think it's 28. My point is when with the Torelli map, you go from here to here, right? So in those two cases, they have the same dimension. So you can recover every, so with another words, the Torelli map says that the general principally polarized abelian variety of dimensions three and two are Jacobians of some curve. Okay. And this is actually generically finite. You cannot say all because you have things on the boundary, for instance, the product of elliptic curves. Well, this is a Jacobian of the product of two curves. So it's not a smooth curve, right? You have to do something else on the boundary, and then we will see what's happening about. But people were very happy with this because you can study AG through curves. So this is, let's say, the philosophy. Philosophy is study AG through the geometry of curves. Okay. So people ask, okay, can I get, and this is very successful because you can study the singularities of the theta divisors and so on, too many things. So the question is that now is, can we get other principally polarized abelian varieties using curves? And the answer is yes, some more. So for that, we are going to introduce the prim varieties. Prim varieties. Consider first a double covering. Consider a double covering between curves, between smooth curves. Mm-hmm. Let's call it P or pi, T tilde C, such as the genus of C is G and the genus of C tilde is G tilde. Okay, so you can compute with the Hurwitz formula, you can compute G tilde in terms of G, in terms of the ramification as well. But so this map induces a map between the Jacobian. And in fact, it's a homomorphism of groups called the norm map. The norm map of P, mm-hmm, between the Jacobians, and taking advantage of the my description of the Jacobians, that they parameterize line bundles of degree zero. Well, I can take a divisor of degree zero upstairs, linear equivalence, like the class of the linear equivalence, so it defines a line bundle of degree zero, and take the push forward of this divisor. So push forward, just take the image of these points and make the sum, right? So the only condition is this, the coefficients, the sum of the coefficients is zero, they are integers, okay? So in terms of divisors, it's very, very easy to define. And it's also clearly an homomorphism of the groups, with respect the sum and everything else.
Angela, okay. That is pi, yes. Right, the F.
Yes.
No, that's, I mean, it was clear. I just wanted to.
Thank you. No, it's good that you pointed out because yes, I mix up my notation sometimes. Yes, I mix up in my notes too. Okay, it's pi. That's right. Mm-hmm. So that means the connected component. So, but the kernel, okay, the kernel can have several components, but one component contains the neutral element of the Jacobian, the zero, and this is going to be my prim variety. Okay, so let's define the prim variety. We define the prim variety associated to the cover of pi by take the kernel of the norm map pi and take the connected component containing the zero. Mm-hmm. So this is naturally a subgroup of the Jacobian C tilde. which is, it's a subvariety also, which is a subvariety, a subgroup also of dimension, well, just the dimension, let's call it this P, and you want to put pi here because it's associated to the morphism. The dimension is the difference of the dimensions, right? G tilde minus G. Moreover, it comes with a polarization. Well, we can restrict the theta divisor, the principal polarization, to this subvariety. So it carries a natural polarization, namely, just take principal polarization C tilde and restrict it to B. Okay. Now the question is, when did I get a principal polarization? And actually, this is one of the exercises. I think it's the last exercise of the list. I will tell you the answer, but you can look at the how do you prove that. So there is a nice theorem by Mumford. So the paper of Mumford I'm referring to is already posted, so you can have a look as well, which says that the restriction theta tilde restricted to P to the prime is algebraic equivalent to twice a principal polarization with principal on P. So let me put here algebraic equivalence. Two cases happen. P is a tal, or P is ramified in exactly two points. Okay. So Tinsy, let's do some observations. So first of all, this definition I gave, I started by simplicity, just by simplicity, I started with a double covering. But there is nothing that tells me that the covering has to be degree 2. It could be any degree. And I can still define the general map. So I should put the name. The norm map. And you can still get the kernel of the norm map as a subvariety, abelian subvariety. The thing is that, first remark, the definition also holds for D bigger than 2. So the degree of the map bigger than 2. Okay, not only double coverings. And so if you consider all the possible degree, the only cases where you obtain a principal polarization are these two. So for D bigger than C, there are only two other cases where the restriction induces a principal polarization. In principle. And those are the following. One is, this is P is of degree 3. So P is triple cyclic covering over a genus 2 curve. So in this case, The covering upstairs is genus 4. And associate the bring varieties of dimension 2. And there is another little case. P is any finite map of any degree. Any finite map. so any degree, but yet now the curve upstairs is genus 2 and downstairs is 1. So give, yeah. So again, for Riemann-Hurwitz formula, you can it allows any d is allowed, yeah. But it's not so interesting because of the dimension, the prime variety will have an elliptic curve. So this case is less interesting, but this is possible. Yes.
It's actually not cyclic. The first.
Non-cyclic. Yes.
Non-Galois. Non-cyclic.
Non-cyclic.
For cyclic, it's not the case.
Mm-hmm. That's right. Thank you. I am thinking of the other. Yes, I was working on cyclic and then. Okay, it's non-cyclic. That's right. Okay, so and that's all. So you cannot get anything principal apart from what Mumford gave. So let me pick alternatively another way of looking at the prime, just to. You can start with a curve with an involution and define the curve C as the quotient of the involution. And define, so this what I said, the norm map is also equivalent to define the prime map as the image. Okay, we have an involution. So the involution, every time you have an automorphism of the curve, the covering, that induces an endomorphism of the Jacobian. Because you can take the pullback of line bundles through this element. So then you take the identity map in the Jacobian minus the induced involution on the endomorphism, and this is also the prime variety. Okay, and one can check that these two definitions are equivalent. So we can think of the prime variety is the iota. Okay, iota. Anti-invariant part of the Jacobian upstairs. Okay, the invariant part is the pullback of, if this is pi, you always have the pullback map between, so now is from downstairs to upstairs. Yeah, so just take any line bundle of degree zero. The pullback is a line bundle of degree zero on C tilde. And in the case of etal coverings, so when pi is etal, this has a kernel. So the kernel of P is generated by, I call it again eta. Eta is a two torsion point. It's a line bundle such as the square is trivial. Okay. In any case, the pullback of the Jacobian is the iota invariant part. So let's put it like this. And invariant part, because actually you can see it as the, this is that's the image from 1 plus iota. So it acts, iota acts here trivially. And this, the prime is the orthogonal to the pullback of the Jacobian downstairs. actually is more is complementary. So we have an isogeny. You have always an isogeny. We define as isogeny yesterday. From the product, so you take the invariant part times the anti-invariant part, and you sum. It's just the sum. So both components are inside of the Jacobian sigilla, so you can sum the elements. And this is an isogeny because both sides have the same dimension and it's surjective. So say, okay. Good. Okay, let's stop a little bit here. Do you have any questions?
Yes, sorry, Angela, this last map so can be a covering, right?
Which one?
The last one.
Yes, the last map here is surjective. So when I say isogeny, yes. Maybe I should recall here, isogeny means it's surjective plus both are the same dimension. Yes. So in particular, the kernel is finite. It's a finite subgroup. Mm-hmm. Okay. Now, from now, let's assume that we are in the TAL case. In the TAL case, we have a kernel. When it's not the TAL, the kernel, the pullback is injective. It's an embedding. Yes, but let's assume that P is the TAL. So okay, the TAL. When I say the TAL, I say unramified covering. And in this case, one can show that the kernel of the norm map pi, it has two components. Our prim, well, maybe I should put P0, but this is my prim, and another component. So this one contains the zero and not the other. So this, yeah, this one is an actual abelian subvariety. So two irreducible, two connected components. And one way of distinguishing, there are several ways of distinguishing these two components, but one way is you can see P, the actual prim, so let me call P of pi, as the image, as I said, of this endomorphism, but of the peak zero. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Ah. And the other, you can see this as the image of this endomorphism, but not of the peak zero, but the peak one. Now I'm confused because I am using that's right, of the peak one. Okay, so this one, again, this was natural, the Jacobian. And this peak, C, peak one is isomorphic. You see, all these peak G, et cetera, they are isomorphisms to the Jacobians. They are isomorphic. The difference is that the Jacobian has a zero and not the others. but when you take a line bundle of degree one, and so let's just to make it clear what is it. I have one iota, I take a line bundle of degree one, you know, C tilde, this is just to take L, that means, so in notation of line bundles, this L tensor pullback of the iota L inverse. So the new line bundle will have now degree zero, okay? So it lies in peak zero, in the Jacobian. Okay, but it's the other component. Okay, this is one way of distinguishing. And as I said, when there's a TAL, you have a kernel. It comes always with this two torsion point, eta. And in the other sense, around is also true. So okay, let me now define it one for all. What is the two torsion point? So this is a notation for the elements eta in the Jacobian, such that twice this is eta. So well, you see, I see it as a line bundle is trivial. Or you prefer, you see, I put pick zero. Yeah, to make it go. So this is isomorphic to Jacobian. And when you put in the Jacobian, actually, two times theta is zero. This is the same under this identification. So this is the two torsion points. Points. And you can define n torsion points. This is similar. So n torsion points. But I wouldn't need it now. Mostly n torsion. So you put here instead. You need to take so there are n roots of the trivial bundle. Yeah, roots. this is a finite subgroup, and we know the cardinality. So in general, this subgroup will have 2 to the g elements. Okay, and you can count that because you can look at the lattice. The lattice, those points will be half of the lattice in any direction. So you can count how many points you have. Okay. Mm-hmm. So every time you have a curve together with a two torsion point, non-trivial one, so I don't want the zero one, you can associate to that an etal double covering. Double covering. In the following way. So system. Mm-hmm. So you have an isomorphism with OC. And this isomorphism and those the sum of these two line bundles with an OC algebra structure or a ring structure actually we need with a ring structure. Okay, so this has, so I can multiply elements on OC with here, with elements of C of clear, is clear, OC mid eta, and I can multiply element eta square eta via this isomorphism. So I have a ring structure in this shift. So you actually the C tilde is defined as the spectrum of this ring. And it also has an injection of OC here, of the trivial line bundle. So that induces a projection of the spectrum. Yeah. OC, and this is our C. So this is pi, yeah? This is a way of seeing a okay. Mm-hmm. So let me define with this equivalence in mind. Let's define another modular space RG. The isomorphism classes of pair C eta such that C is a smooth curve of genus G, and eta is two torsion point minus zero. So I don't want the trivial, the zero or the trivial bundle, because the trivial bundle will define something that is disconnected. Yeah, so yeah. When eta is zero, what you get is twice the copy of C, and this is not, yeah, I want a connected curve, right? I don't want this one, this case. So this is the space. This is moduli space, which parametrizing metal double covers. Coverings.
Mm-hmm.
And okay, so you have naturally, let's put the color. You have naturally a map from RG to MG. It's the forgetful map. And so you take this pair, you forget the torsion point. And as I mentioned, this is of degree 2G minus 1. It's finite. It's finite. Okay. I want to say something, yes.
Angela, remember you have to take a 5 minute break.
Oh, no. Thank you. Thank you for telling me. Okay, then let's stop here. I think it's a good moment to stop. Yes.
Forget ETA in your writing.
Yes, thank you. Yes, that is a sign that I needed the break. Thank you. Yes. Okay, we forget ETA. So, okay, I leave you the thing here for 5 minutes.